Hi, Diana.
Hi, Liz.
You work with universities to issue bonds to help finance their operations, just given the obvious toll that the pandemic has taken on institutions of higher education. How are they coping with their financing needs?
The colleges are under a fair amount of stress because of the COVID pandemic, and one of the things they have done is substantially increase the amount of debt they have taken on to give them some more flexibility in their operating budgets. At the beginning of the year, the universities were primarily borrowing to refinance debt they had taken out about 10 years ago and finance some new capital projects on campus. But now with the COVID pandemic and some campuses being closed and getting ready to open for the fall, they have been looking to refinance debt as well as issue more taxable debt, which allows them to have more flexibility on the use of the bond proceeds to give themselves a little more opportunity to be able to handle the stress of the pandemic. And we have seen a tremendous amount of debt issued in the market, approximately $45 billion worth of debt in the public markets recently, with about two-thirds of that in the taxable market and about one-third in the tax-exempt market.
And with students heading back to college right now, how are universities thinking about financing for the upcoming academic year?
Schools are taking a variety of approaches this fall, ranging from totally on campus to a hybrid learning to online learning. And the types of delivery methods they're using are very dependent on a number of items. The first is, what state are they located in? What kind of rules do they have to comply with? Where are their students coming from? And what kind of physical environment can the university offer? Do they have enough housing to be able to provide the social distancing that we need for students? Do they have facilities available in case students are actually infected with COVID? How are they going to handle that? Some of the moves to an online education also create some other stresses for the university because they're not able to charge the same tuition in many circumstances for the online learning environment, and students will feel more comfortable if they are receiving a lower bill for their tuition if they are doing the online learning. Other things that are going to be negatives for universities is the fact that their auxiliary revenues are going to be under pressure. Students pay bills for housing, for dining, for parking, and in many circumstances for other activities on campus.
And how about athletics, which is such a critical source of revenue for some institutions?
One of the things I'd like to let people know is that in general, athletics do not make money for most universities, but some of the larger universities that do have very robust athletic programs, football programs in particular, those revenues do help fund other activities on campus for other sports. So we have seen circumstances where some of the larger conferences, such as the Pac-12 and the Big Ten, are not going to be playing football in the fall. They might be playing in the spring. So we're going to be seeing some changes on campus in terms of what kind of campus life there is, what kinds of activities are we going to have for donors and alumni coming back to campus. So it will be an interesting fall semester for some schools that still do have sports, because there will not be the same level of competitions available at the national championships. But I think there are many institutions that are hoping to have some very robust sports activities available for the students, the alumni, and the local communities.
So as schools deal with these financial pressures, how are investors in higher education bonds reacting?
Investors have still shown some strong demand for higher education bonds, but they are watching schools closely to see how they handle the opening of campus for the fall and potentially a second wave of the COVID environment. Investors have been attracted to the higher education sector for many years, as many of these credits are very strong, have very large endowments, and do have robust student demand. But there are some other institutions on the smaller side that do not have the same level of financial reserves and the same level of student demand. So we have seen some change in the way investors are looking at some of those stressed institutions, and the rating agencies are also getting a little concerned about some of the second or third tier public universities that may be under pressure for a lack of state funding, and some of the smaller institutions that might be in rural areas or in states where the K through 12 population is declining, where the potential flow of new students into those schools may be on the decline.
And besides issuing bonds, what are some other ways that universities are managing the financial impact of COVID?
Universities are looking at not just the debt side of their balance sheet, they're also looking at the expenses that they take on. They're really evaluating what types of program offerings are they doing, can they cut out some programs to become more focused on the academic programs that they're offering. They're examining the level of faculty that they need to have, as well as the facilities. What type of facilities use are they going to be needing in the future? Now that so many of their workers are working remotely, there may be a change in the way the academic institution operates into the future. And other institutions are also thinking about monetizing assets. Do they really need all the acres of land they have in their campus? Do they need all of their buildings? Can they maybe reconfigure what they're doing? So it's a variety of things that we have seen for institutions. Some are looking to maybe merge with other institutions or potentially monetize some of their royalty income streams or other revenues that they have typically just depended on to balance their budgets.
So finally, Diana, what do you think some of the long-lasting impacts of the pandemic might be on higher education?
Well, I see higher education as an opportunity for a student to create their own personal brand and become a lifelong member of a living and learning community. But many of those attributes are, you know, developed in an on-campus setting. And now that we may have more of a hybrid or online learning community, how is that going to impact the way students and their families determine whether or not higher education is worth the cost? And another thing that we'll have to see is how do they remain connected with their community if they're going to be online for a major part of their academic time? And one thing we do have to be on the lookout for, as we have seen at some institutions that have opened for students, is as students get back together with their friends and they're so excited to see their friends and share what has been going on over the summer and during the pandemic lockdown, they're also sharing their germs. And the universities and what's happening on campus could end up being a bit of a harbinger for what's to come for cities.
Thanks, Diana.
Thank you, Liz. It was very nice to talk to you today.
You too.